You become a crab, but you cannot give precise answers. Did you do it?
Perhaps.
You already know what the f*** is up. It's time for CRABS.
My God! Okay, it's happening!
Everyone likes CRABS. Everyone wants to be a crab. At least on this channel, you guys are nuts about CRABS. CRABS are the obvious ideal form. So today I'm gonna introduce you to some cool CRABS I think that you will like, with more and more emphasis on the think as we go along, because the CRABS tend to get more heinous as the video goes on. By the end of it, I genuinely don't know if you will even stand to look at them, but I'm gonna try it out anyway. So here are some CRABS I think that you will like. Let's get the general information out of the way. I will not be starting off by defining what a crab is. If you don't know why, go watch this video, because I cannot stand to re-explain the pandemonium that is the definition of a crab. In the simplest words possible, there are true crabs, there are false crabs that look like true crabs and we call crabs, and there are animals that are not true crabs, don't look like crabs, and are still called crab. The crab form is just desirable, which is why crustaceans everywhere have opted in to carcinization, the process of evolving a crab form. The true crabs, in the group called Brachyura, founded the original crab shape about 200 million years ago, and like the pattern of every designer brand we know today, the knockoff started popping up shortly after, mostly in Brachyura's sister group, Anomura, also known as the false crabs. Most of the crabs in today's video are true, honest crabs, but there is one false crab worth mentioning. So, let's start off with the true crabs. The first ones on our lineup today like to get dressed up and fancy, the decorator crab, which is not just one crab, but describes an assortment of species that use various items to decorate their bodies. They're covered in these bristles called setae that kind of function like Velcro. They use their pinchers to grab some sort of material and then rub the material all over their setae until it gets attached, getting hooked onto it or tangled in it or impaled by it. Depends on the type of setae. Sometimes the material doesn't stick quickly enough to their liking, so the crabs will use their mouths to change the shape of it. Kind of imagine it like a little rodent. That's so stupid. Whatever, till it fits all nice in the sea. Decorator crabs are found in warm, shallow waters all over the world, where marine life is generally hustling and bustling. So, as you would imagine, there's lots of material in those environments to decorate themselves with, like sponge, algae, seaweed, pieces of urchin or coral, tiny rocks, shells, fucking chips of concrete, anything, really. They're not picky. They're like maximalist collectors, like hoarders, but artsy. This behavior is not just for fun, though, and you can probably guess the two main reasons why they do it. Yeah. Camouflage and defense against predators. Covering yourself in items from your environment naturally helps you blend into your environment and stay hidden from plain view. Some species just get naturally covered in stuff as they're crawling around, which I guess some might just consider a dirty crab rather than a decorator crab, a whole crab. But sometimes the stuff they used to decorate with is toxic, which is the best case scenario for them, like a piece of anemone or other animal with stingers. They can essentially cover themselves in shields of poison, which is fucking sick. It makes a predator spit them right out. Decorating also helps the crab conduct ambush attacks. A motionless, dirty crab can easily be mistaken for a piece of reef, and then boom, snatch a bitch right up. Since this is a behavior, it would be pretty much impossible to figure out when this started happening, but scientists do have a good idea of why the behavior evolved. It seems to be linked to their feeding behavior, which also involves finding materials they deem suitable. It's thought that early decorator crabs attach material to their setae with the intention of eating it later, already a smart as fuck thing to do, but also came with the added benefit of camouflage, an instant advantage over their competitors, since they likely stayed hidden from predators more effectively, allowing them to survive long enough to pass on their genes at a higher rate to the next generation. This eventually turned into attaching material for camouflage alone instead of stored food. But some decorator crabs do still eat their decorations from time to time, just hopefully not the concrete, unless that is their next ideal form. The next crab on this lineup is a specific type of decorator crab called the arrowhead crab, or arrow crab. They kind of look like they're made out of toothpicks, and I love it. They're found in shallow water habitats all down the Western Atlantic Ocean, from North Carolina to Brazil. They've been known to live in groups of up to 6 individuals, which is cool. That is a cool fact about a crab, and that's all there really is to them. Just cool toothpick looking crab. So, next. This next one, I don't know if it could be considered a decorator crab because they hold stuff in their pinchers rather than attaching stuff to their setae, but I'm keeping them in the same general group for the sake of organization. I think you will like them because they are cute, but also feisty. Another true crab, the pom-pom crab, also known as Hawaiian boxer crabs because they carry around venomous sea anemones as boxing gloves. Despite that name, they don't actually use the sea anemones as boxing gloves. They mostly just wave them around like cheerleaders with menacing pom-poms. Scientists aren't too sure why they don't actually box with them because it seems like a reasonable thing to do. They've witnessed pom-pom crabs getting into little duels, but it's mostly just threat displays rather than an actual respectable punch. It's essentially all the shit talking that leads up to the boxing match, and then no boxing match. It just ends. It might be because the anemones are so toxic that a slip of the wrist might lead to the harm of both individuals. Or maybe the anemones, which by the way are typically species Triactus producta, are non-toxic to the crabs, so there's no point in using them in a duel. Either way, it helps in some scenarios, which is why they do it, such as wading off predators while moving around while they're eating. That's reason enough right there. They've essentially got an AR-15 strapped to their chest, practicing their right to open carry at the local Chipotle. Insane behavior. Yes, but there is absolutely no one that is gonna fuck with them. So, success. All right, the next couple crabs on the list, I'm gonna be honest, I don't know if you're gonna like them. And it gets more questionable as we go along, so just keep that in mind. I like them because they're maniacs. So I think that you will like them, hence the reason why they're in the video, but just a little disclaimer. Okay, so this next one, I hope that you will like, is the Japanese spider crab.
Perhaps.
Not so fucking big. They are the largest crab and even largest arthropod alive that we know of, but the largest getting to 12 and a half feet across, legs included in that, of course. Some of the arthropods we're about to get into in the History of Life series are often cited as the biggest of all time, but I've only seen numbers between like 8 to 10 feet. So am I crazy, or does that make the Japanese spider crab the biggest arthropod of all time that we know of? I guess it depends on if you think the legs have a right to count that much. But anyway, Japanese spider crabs tend to live in deeper waters from Japan all the way down to Taiwan. They're found at depths of up to 2,000 feet below the surface of the ocean, but come up to shallower waters during mating season. And by the way, they're also true crabs. Now you might be thinking, I'm not sold. This creature seems godforsaken. I don't see how I could possibly like this. Well, how about this? They're also decorator crabs. The juveniles decorate. That's pretty cute, yeah? The adults don't have to decorate because they're fucking massive, so their size does enough. But hey, decorators as kids is better than no decoration at all, in my book. I think that's fucking cute. They also move really slow. They literally just hang out, scavenging for remains of dead animals and plant matter that grows on their arms that they scrape off and eat, which probably lost you there. Yeah. Okay, how about this? They can live up to 100 years old. That's pretty sick. All right, whatever. If you don't like them, that's fine, but I will need you to definitely strap in for this next one. Matter of fact, double strap in. The only false crab on our list today, the coconut crab, the sewer rats of the crab lineage. Here's why. They are thieves. They are uncomfortably large and do things you wouldn't like them to given their size. They are circumstantially poisonous and their diet is asinine. Let me break it down. As you can see, they live on land exclusively. Adults will drown in the ocean. Yes, this crab will drown in the ocean. They have a respiratory system that developed exclusively for air, which is fine on its own, I guess. You know, a crab exclusively living on an air-breathing crab is fine, but they get to like 3 feet long and hold the record for the heaviest and largest living terrestrial invertebrate that we know of. That, combined with the fact that their life is on land, makes me a little bit uncomfortable, to be honest. Just feels like something that went wrong, you know? Like that shouldn't have happened. Coconut crabs aren't born on land though. After two coconut crabs mate, the females release the eggs into the water. Even though the adults don't live in water, they're still generally near it, on the east coast of parts of Africa and some surrounding islands in the Indo-Pacific. When the eggs hatch in the water, the larvae spread out all over logs and floating coconuts for like 4 to 6 weeks. Then they go into their next stage, which is like a shrimp-like stage. They look like shrimp. They live in the seabed for a while. And then they start moving towards the shore, spend some time in the high tide zone, and then go to land, where they live for up to 60 years. Yeah, 60. As adults, they dig these insane burrows underneath the roots of coconut trees and line the burrows with husks of coconuts. So, as you would guess from what their name suggests, the coconut crab eats coconuts, specifically young green coconuts, which means yes, they scale trees for coconuts. This 3 foot long crab has legs like claws. They use to fucking free solo up a tree, rip open a young coconut and eat the flesh inside. Do you know what kind of strength it takes to open up a coconut? Have you ever tried to rip open a coconut? Their pinchers are absolute weapons. In 2016, scientists tested a ton of crabs to see what the strength of their pinchers was. Found out they have a maximum pinch force of over 1700 newtons. For comparison, our bite force is like max 1300 newtons. Coconut crabs also have the strength to lift a 10-year-old if they wanted to, and they've been known to crush the fingers of people who handle them in a way they don't like, which, valid. If you were to classify crabs as different states, the coconut crab would definitely be Florida, because not only do they eat young coconuts, they've also been known to eat various fallen fruits, nuts, but also rats, chickens, seabirds, other crabs, and really anything they can get their big meaty claws around. They've been seen climbing trees to hunt birds, dude. A crab climbing a tree to attack and eat a bird. Depending on the ecosystem, they can function as the apex predator, which is, that shouldn't be allowed. This reputation has led to a very unusual coconut crab conspiracy, the CCC, if you will, that suggests the reason why Amelia Earhart was never found is because she was eaten by coconut crabs. But what is not a conspiracy is the fact that they are thieves. Coconut crabs are also known as robber crabs. They have been seen stealing various items like cookware, clothes, and cutlery. They have been seen fighting over a watch from a pile of clothes. And one was seen dragging a bottle of whiskey behind it, which is just obvious sewer rat behavior. And finally, I mentioned that they are circumstantially poisonous. They're not poisonous on their own, but something about their diet makes them poisonous on occasion. It's thought to be the sea mango that has this effect, but there have been cases of coconut crab poisoning. Different groups eat the coconut crab. Some islands consider them an aphrodisiac, while others consider them a bad luck charm that can lead to serious illness and even death. Both reputations may be due to poison? Who's to say, really? Regardless, coconut crabs are from the trenches, and for that reason, I think they belong on this list. But let me know what you think, and also let me know if you want me to make a part two, because I have more crabs that I could show you. Alright, on to the questions! If you weren't so dead set on cramming evolutionary theory down our throats, I'd be more inclined to watch your content.
You serious?
From a scientific point of view, what is your idea of souls and how humans are different from other species in the way that only we have a soul? This is definitely more of a philosophical question that kind of starts with what you would count as a soul. Like, if you consider consciousness an indicator of a soul, then humans are not the only animals with souls. There are plenty of books with research on studying consciousness in different animals and whether or not they can, you know, recognize themselves in a mirror. I don't have the one that I'm reading right now. I packed it up because I'm moving. But this is kind of a tricky question to answer because understanding, like measuring consciousness is really difficult, and using these, you know, human-made parameters to figure out if an animal is conscious is not, it's just really biased. And so obviously right now we're in a time of scientific discovery that we're realizing that a lot of previous understandings of the level of intelligence of animals, fuck, why did I choose this one? This one's really philosophical. No matter what we do when we study other species, we're gonna be biased in our understanding of the species because we just can't possibly separate ourselves from the human experience. So our understanding of what animals have a soul, i.e. consciousness, is just gonna be really flawed, I think, for a very long time. And as time goes on, we're gonna continue to learn that a lot of animals are a lot more advanced than we gave them credit for, and that's already happening. We used to think that all species of snakes were solitary and they didn't like interacting with other snakes, but it turns out garter snakes live in groups and have like actual like friend groups and look for each other and find each other when they get separated. We're starting to have fucking conversations with whales using AI. I think consciousness is going to be expressed in a variety of ways that we just don't know how to interpret right now, or maybe ever, who knows. But I think the study of that is really interesting, and I've been getting into some books about it. I've been reading one for a while. I've only read a couple chapters. I think it's Consciousness by Susan Blackmore. So if you want to read more about it, check that out. I think chapter 10 specifically talks about consciousness in other animals. So yeah, I would say humans are not as unique as we think. And I'm excited as time goes on to learn even more proof of that. If you have a weird animal you want identified or a question you want answered, maybe not necessarily as deep as that one, but if you want to, go ahead. Let me know in the comments and I might feature it in the next video. So be sure to subscribe so you don't miss it. And so you don't miss the next episode of the History of Life on Earth that we know of. Check out my Patreon for our Discord server and live streams. And for now, stay curious. The world has a lot for us to learn. See ya! I can't say anemones too many times in a row. Anemone. Or maybe the anemone. 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 Anemone.